Hey guys, welcome to MediFaction. Today, let's learn about vasculitis. So generally, the term vasculitis is used for vessel wall inflammation. It includes constitutional signs and symptoms like fever, arthralgia, myalgia, and malaise. Classification schemes attempt to group vasculitis according to vessel diameter, role of immune complexes, presence of specific antibodies, granuloma formation, organ specificity, and even population demographics. But here, we are classifying vasculitis into infectious and non-infectious, and we will be stressing on non-infectious. So, on the basis of non-infectious vasculitis, it is classified into large vessel vasculitis, medium vessel vasculitis, and small vessel vasculitis. So as I told earlier, we are going to stress on non-infectious vasculitis. So these are some of the common denominators they possess, which are immune complex deposition, anti-neutrophil cytoplasmic antibody, that is ANCA, and anti-endothelial cell antibody, and also autoreactive T cells. These are the common denominators they possess. So, going in detail. As I already mentioned, we have large vessel vasculitis, also known as granulomatous disease. We have medium vessel vasculitis as well as small vessel vasculitis. And they also possess some subtopics such as Takayasu's arthritis, and giant cell arthritis, which comes under the large vessel vasculitis, and we have polyarthritis nodosa and Kawasaki's disease under medium vessel vasculitis, and finally we have microscopic polyangiitis, Wegener's granulomatosis, and Chern-Strauss disease under small vessel vasculitis. Now let's learn all these in detail. First of all, giant cell arthritis. This is the most common arthritis among older individuals, which is rare before 50 years. Chronic inflammatory disorder of large to small size vessel principally involving temporal arteries. Ophthalmic arterial involvement can cause permanent blindness. T cell mediated immune response. That means we can see lymphocyte infiltration in the arterial wall. These are also characterized by granulomatous inflammation centered on internal elastic lamina. Therefore, we can see inflammatory reactions inside the elastic lamina. The heal stage is marked by medial attenuation and scarring. So right here, we can appreciate. And this right here is the dense inflammatory infiltrate with multinucleated giant cells along the internal elastic lamina, resulting into this. Next is Takayasu's arthritis. The granulomatous vasculitis of medium to large sized vessels characterized by ocular disturbances and marked weakening of the pulses in the upper extremities. Therefore, the Takayasu's arthritis is also known as pulseless disease. This classically involves aortic arch and individuals below 50 years of age. Pulmonary, renal, and coronary are affected in half the cases. So right here, we can appreciate the aortic arch being involved. This is the aortic arch, and here we can see the vasculitis. And here we can clearly see the fibrosis inflammatory cell infiltrate comprising of mononuclear cells and multinucleated cells. Next one is polyarthritis nodosa, which comes under medium sized. So these are Systemic vasculitis of small to medium-sized vessel wall, typically involving renal and visceral vessel sparing pulmonary artery. 30% of patients have HBs antigen antibody complex, and these are characterized by transmural necrotizing inflammation with luminal thrombosis and rapidly accelerating hypertension, abdominal pain, bloody stools, myalgia, and also neuritis. Kawasaki disease. These are vasculitis characterized by acute febrile, usually self-limited illness of infancy and childhood. This vasculitis resembles PAN, that is polyarthritis nodosa, and is characterized by conjunctival and oral erythema, blistering, and edema of hands and feet, erythema of palms and also soles, and cervical lymph node enlargement. Because of all these symptoms, these are also known as mucocutaneous lymph node syndrome. Next is microscopic polyangiitis. This comes under small vessels. These are necrotizing vasculitis that generally affects capillaries as well as small arterioles and venules. Leukocytoclasia is seen. What is leukocytoclasia? In leukocytoclasia, we will be able to see dead debris along neutrophils around small blood vessels. And these are characterized by hemoptysis, hematuria, proteinuria, bowel bleeding, and pain along with palpable cutaneous purpura. Now let's move on to Chern-Strauss vasculitis. It is a small vessel vasculitis classically associated with asthma, allergies, rhinitis, lung infiltrates, peripheral eosinophilia, and extravasated necrotizing granulomas. Multisystem diseases with cutaneous gastrointestinal tract and renal involvement. Next is granulomatosis with polyangiitis. Necrotizing vasculitis is characterized by a triad of necrotizing granulomas of the upper respiratory or the lower respiratory tract, also necrotizing or granulomatous vasculitis along with focal necrotizing or crescentic glomerulonephritis. Now let's move on to the vascular tumors. These are characterized into benign neoplasms, intermediate grade neoplasms, and malignant neoplasms. In case of benign neoplasms, there are certain types such as hemangioma, lymphangioma, glomastoma, vascular ectasia, and reactive vascular proliferation. And hemangioma also has some subcategories such as capillary hemangioma, cavernous hemangioma, and pyogenic granuloma. In case of intermediate grade neoplasms, the types are Kaposi sarcoma and hemangioendothelioma. And finally, under malignant neoplasms, we have angiosarcoma and hemangioendothelioma. So here we can illustrate the capillary hemangioma, which comes under the benign type. And here you can appreciate the benign vascular tumors characterized by presence of small blood vessels arranged in lobules with RBCs in their lumen and is lined by plumped endothelial cells. This is an example of cavernous hemangioma, which is characterized by large dilated blood vessels lined by flattened endothelial cells. Now let's move on to the intermediate grade neoplasms. We have the Kaposi sarcoma. Initially, classic Europeans described in 1872 into non-HIV associated. After that, recently the African pre-HIV now describes it into HIV negative and HIV positive. Then there is transplant associated, which is HIV negative. Then there is AIDS Kaposi sarcoma, which is caused by human herpes virus 8, also known as KSHV. In case of Kaposi sarcoma, the lesion progress is from patch, then later into plaque, and finally into nodules. Angiosarcoma. Angiosarcoma is a malignant endothelial neoplasm that primarily affects the older individuals. There is equal gender predilection and can occur at any site. Hepatic angiosarcoma is associated with arsenic and thorotrast exposure. Angiosarcoma can arise in the settings of lymph edema. Cutaneous angiosarcoma can begin as multiple deceptively small and asymptomatic red papules or nodules. Microscopically, all degrees of differentiation can be seen, from plump, atypical endothelial cells forming vascular channels to wildly undifferentiated tumors. Hope you understood the video. Like, subscribe, and press the bell button for more videos. Thank you. Thanks for watching.